Hi everyone, Dennis Foley from Acoustic Fields. I've been going through some of my notes and emails, and I see a lot of the same issues repeating themselves. So I kind of came up with a list of acoustic rules, if you will. I have about 10 of them that we're going to outline. We're going to start today with the first rule of acoustics. It's kind of like the mantra that physicians practice, and it's the do no harm rule. When you're building a building, we have two parts. When you're building a room, we have two parts that we have to consider. We have the shell and we have the treatment. Both require special sciences, both require special materials, and both are really unique. There's some overlap in the disciplines, but the structures themselves kind of run by different rules, and people get these rules confused all the time. They think that treatment is a substitute for shell. They don't confuse shell technology or barrier technology with treatment technology a lot of time, but there's a lot of confusion on sound absorption being a shell type of a treatment, which in most cases it's not. So if we break our room into two parts, we have the treatment and the shell side. On the treatment side, you must match the size and the volume to the usage because the room is only so big. We can only put so much energy in it before the room starts to react to the excess energy. How does it react in the low frequency side? It reacts with modal pressures, which are smothering and blurring a lot of other frequencies. So we have to match our energy and volume, our energy output into the room and the volume of the room to make sure it's able to handle it. I get emails every day where people have small rooms and five subwoofers. I saw a room the other day had 4 18s and 4 12s and 4 15s, and it was no bigger than your average size room. So too much energy causes too many management issues inside the room, so we have to marry the energy and the volume of inside the room. The materials used inside the room have a direct impact on the sound quality of the room. A common material people use is that drywall. We don't use it in any of our builds. MDF and plywood, same cost, much better in terms of sound quality within your room. Here's another issue that we see constantly on the treatment side, and that's absorption rates and levels. People think that absorption is absorption. Nothing could be further from the truth when it comes to music and voice. The rate and levels of absorption that you use has a direct impact on the sound quality of your voice and music. Just ask any microphone. Microphones are very sensitive to rates and levels of absorption. So you have to match the rate and level of absorption to the usage. And a lot of the literature, a lot of the people have this misconception that, you know, building materials are good for voice and music. Well, they're not. They're not at the right rates and levels that you need for voice and music. Voice and music are special. They're different. You don't use building insulation with music. Diffusion is another one. Diffusion has to be married to the usage. You have to pick the frequency response of the diffuser. How far is it from the listening position? What are we doing in the room? Are we recording live music? Are we recording voice? Is it a control room? Are we concerned with the reflections off the rear wall? Are we using absorption in the front part of the room and diffusion in the rear? So all of these things have to be taken into consideration on the treatment side. The shell side is the barrier. The shell is the barrier that isolates our room from noise, and it also keeps the noise from going out. So it has this double valve, if you will. It must keep the sound or the energy within the room and then keep the noise that's external to the room from getting into it. So this is vibration transmission. This is controlling the vibration signature of the materials that you use. And the first thing that you have to do is not guess. You must quantify your noise issue through measurements. You must find out what the frequency is that's causing the noise, how big it is, because the measurements determine exactly what materials you use in the barrier or the shell. So the numbers tell you exactly what to do. A lot of people guess at this, and they always guess wrong. because there's a direct correspondence to the frequency and the amplitude of the noise issue that you have and what materials you're going to use for the barrier. So we call it barriers by numbers. And you got to quantify and measure first. It's not difficult. You can do it on an iPhone. And we can show you apps to do that. It's not complicated. For those that are really serious, you can do noise studies. But for most people's usages, there has to be a relationship between the amount of noise that you're trying to block from coming into the structure and leaving the structure and the barrier that you use to block it. Makes sense, right? Here's a good example. Barriers that are dealing with energy above 125 cycles are way different than barriers that are less than 125 cycles. That's kind of the break point. The mass, the density, the arrangements of the materials become much more critical when you're dealing with lower frequency energy. So it's all dependent on the numbers. You must know what the problem is. You must know how large the problem is in order to construct the correct barrier to solve the problem. Here's a common example we see all the time. Well, I built two walls. I separated them from airspace with an airspace. I hung drywall. And I'm not happy with the low end. It just goes right through it. Well, it does because it's not designed to handle energy less than 125 cycles. And this is another common thing in the literature that's not true. Window placement. You have to remember, do no harm. Window placement, door placement. You must be really careful about where you put these because they have a direct impact on sound quality. And consistency in surface areas is really important. So the last thing we want on our mixing console, if there's our channel and our seats, is a window here and maybe a door here. Or a window here and maybe a door here. So we have to be very careful at where we place these things. And there are also noise sources. So we have to be very careful about, are they going to be strong enough? Because noise is like water. It goes to the weakest part of our structure. Well, our windows and our doors are the weakest part of our structure. So treatment and shell, those are our two issues when we're building rooms. And if you're not building rooms, you can still benefit from this analysis. And then the goal is not to do any harm. Don't do anything to make the situation worse. Do things that improve the situation. And if you're building, you have that opportunity. It's much easier to move a line on a piece of paper, a drawing that you're going to build from, than it is to move a wall after you build it and found out that it's not correct. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, give me a thumbs up so I know that it had value to you. And please, if you have any questions, leave them in the comment section and I'll be more than happy to answer them for you. Alternatively, if there are other topics that you wish to discuss or see discussed in a video presentation, send me an email, info@acousticfields.com, and we'll get them on our list and get them done for you. I release a new video about every week, so stay tuned to our YouTube channel and keep updated on our new videos.